Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Gemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Gemma.
Grace and peace to you. Welcome to Ask Pastor Gemma. And every time we get together, I pause to say thank you for your support. I want to tell you how much I appreciate your prayers and your positive feedback, because primarily the feedback is usually positive and encouraging. So thanks again. We give God praise for life, that He spared our lives. And we know that there's a purpose and a reason why God has given us spared lives. There's destiny to be fulfilled. If you're a first timer, welcome to Ask Pastor Gemma. My name is Gemma Duncan. My husband, Apostle Vivian Duncan, and myself are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our headquarters is on the Diego Martin Main Road, opposite Salonix Drive in Trinidad. We have branches in Trinidad, Sangre Grande, Faisabad. We have a branch in Chaguanas. There is also a branch in Tobago and one on the island of Antigua. Our regularly scheduled services are Sunday mornings at 9 a.m., live and online in every branch. And on Thursdays, we have School of Intercession at 7 p.m. online. And on Fridays, or regular service online. Please note that there would be no services on Thursdays and Fridays for the entire month of August, which is the usual practice in Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our office hours, Monday to Thursdays from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And the business center is open from Monday to Fridays from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Now, we just came out of a very powerful conference that we've been talking about for quite some time, Fostering Effective Dynamic Communication, hosted or run by our daughter, Dr. Jade Duncan, and her friend, Dr. Inez Moore, who flew in from California to be with us. And for the next few weeks, couple weeks, 3 weeks, you know, as much as it will take, I want to give little excerpts of what was shared. I felt it was absolutely important that you get a little bit. The conference was well attended. However, those of you who didn't get a chance to attend, you'll get a little pointers. They spoke on conflict management on day one. And the interesting thing is you're going to hear some of it, because we're just going to give you a little bits and pieces. There was intrapersonal conflict, interpersonal conflict, intra-group conflict, and organizational conflict. And the one that jumped out at me was intra-personal conflict. Intra means inside of me. And that thing just kind of blew my mind, that one of the biggest struggles, areas of conflict management that's needed, is me, managing me. And I heard somebody say once, and I have embraced that, my biggest enemy is my inner me. And so take a view of the little bit that will be shared concerning that. Today we want to present part 4.
We're going to be be talking about emotional intelligence, something that we really don't discuss a lot in the church. I think we do a lot of things about feeling and we feel the fire and stuff like that, but we really don't sit in what that means and how that impacts each other and how we're able to really interact in a way that's safe and encouraging and positive amongst each other as brethren, as well as on the workplace. So we're really going to do a little bit of a deep dive this morning. Here's a little bit for those who missed the bio, a little bit of what we do. And this type of setting is what we do, right? We spend a lot of time going all over the place, speaking in conferences, speaking within our organizations about things like this, right? Whether it's leadership development, faculty development, emotional intelligence, just really how can we empower ourselves to be the best? So let's get started. What is emotional intelligence? Emotional intelligence is the ability to sense, understand, and effectively apply the power and acumen of emotions as a source of human energy, information, connection, and influence. And this is Robert K. Cooper. He's one of the first people who coined the term emotional intelligence, as well as John Mayer and Peter Salovey. And they said that emotionally intelligent person is skilled in four areas: identifying emotions, using emotions, understanding emotions, and regulating their emotions. So why is EQ important? Emotional competence is the single most important personal quality that each of us must develop and access to experience a breakthrough. Only through managing our emotions can we access our intellect and our technical competence. An emotionally competent person performs better under pressure. And I don't know how many of you have ever been under pressure, but you want to make sure that under pressure you're not crumbling and you're not falling apart. You're able to perform at your utmost and be optimized situations when you're under pressure. The Center for Creative Leadership says that 75% of careers are derailed for reasons related to emotional competencies. Not your skill set, not your abilities, not your education, not how good you do the job. It's your behavior in the workplace. So including your ability to handle interpersonal problems, we talked about it yesterday, that it's 49% of the issues on the workplace, right? So you can get fired just because people can't be in the room with you. And we call that emotional tax. You may be somebody who is so smart, so brilliant, you're the only one with that particular skill set, and you think that you're irreplaceable, so you can act however you want to act because what are they going to do? They're short staff already. Yeah, but when you're emotionally taxing, it costs the organization more to keep you than to let you go. Because what happens is, yeah, you're brilliant, yeah, you're smart, yeah, you're one of a kind, but everyone around you is necessary. And when they start quitting and they start leaving the job because they don't want to work with you because you make that environment toxic, you are costing the job an emotional tax. So one of the things we look at as leaders and bosses when I do your performance review every year is your emotional tax. How expensive are you for us to manage? And it costs a lot. It costs time, it costs resources, it costs people. And every time you lose somebody and you have to replace them, it costs four times as much to hire somebody new to replace somebody who you already had. It's very expensive. So yeah, we'll get rid of you because of your emotionally taxing behavior. So it's really important to take into consideration how your behavior impacts everybody else.
I just wanted to add on to what Dr. Jade was talking about. So I explained to you my first day that I'm a faculty in educational leadership at Cal State Fullerton. And with my doctoral students, I have a range of doctoral students who are in this particular cohort, and we have professionals in this program that are getting their doctorate in education, and their directors and their deans, and we're going through, obviously, the content about leadership, about education, but in addition to that, I always focus in my courses on emotional intelligence, because I know that they cannot be effective leaders without understanding the human dynamic, which is oftentimes emotional, right? How can you be a good leader, just like Dr. J said, if you do not understand how you're coming across and also how you are able to navigate and respond to the needs of your community, right? The needs of your employees. You need to be able to understand not only their emotions, but how to regulate yours. And we've all been in situations where, unfortunately, our emotions have gotten the best of us. They do not always create opportunities for us to thrive. And it's important for us to have that under control as we're moving into these different positions and being promoted. And in order to do that, you do have to spend some time reflecting on this and learning some skills and strategies to navigate your emotions and navigate the emotions of other folks around you.
All right, so here are some components of emotional intelligence: self-awareness, self-regulation, motivation, empathy, we talked about that yesterday, and social skills. So when it comes to self-awareness, the definition is the ability to recognize and understand your own emotions, strengths, weaknesses, values, and goals. We talked about yesterday in dynamic communication, knowing yourself. This is what this is. Recognizing your emotions as they occur, understanding your strengths and limitations, and having a strong sense of self-worth. So I know I mentioned the book Ego-Free Leadership yesterday, and I had this situation at work where somebody gave me a piece of feedback, right? And first of all, I'm like, that doesn't sound right. And then I realized in that moment, after reading this book, that I was experiencing what the book calls an ego pinch. What it meant was whatever this person said triggered something that already existed in me, whether it was a belief that I had about myself or whether it was something that the environment that I was raised in or the environment that I my past work experiences taught me, whether it was feelings of rejection, whether it was feelings of that I wasn't good enough, right? And then whenever someone challenged me or challenged what I was saying, it made me feel like they were questioning my ability and my skill set, when the truth was they were just asking a question. And then my ego would have caused me to respond in a way that made me seem like I was not emotionally intelligent. My emotions would have gotten the best of me, and I would have responded in a way that was not helpful to the situation, right? So in those situations, whenever you have an ego pinch and you feel a howl, like we say, right? Pause a little bit. Check yourself. And really listen to what the person said to you. And like we mentioned yesterday, if you know what they're saying has a little truth in it, okay, check yourself a little bit. Maybe apologize. I know that's probably a curse word in some places. Apology, yeah? Maybe apologize. Say, I'm sorry. I didn't mean for that to come out that way. Or if it doesn't really mean anything, move on. So there's a quote that says, never react emotionally to criticism. Analyze yourself to determine whether it is justified. If it is, correct yourself. Otherwise, go on about your business. And in those scenarios, you're never going to react emotionally because you don't know what you're talking about, right? So I move on. Or, hey, wow, there may be some truth to this. Let me use this as a learning opportunity so I can grow. There's never a point in time where we don't have anything left to learn. None of us have been to every single country in the world. None of us has experienced everything in the world. And everywhere and every station in our lives, there's somebody who has more than you or doing better than you. So that means there's always room to grow, right? So sometimes when we hear things and we get feedback, it isn't always to criticize us or to make us feel bad. Some people, that may be their intention. But because we are emotionally intelligent, everything is useful. Right? So you may be trying to get me to feel bad about myself, but I'm going to listen to what you say to make sure that nobody else gets a chance to say that about me. And I will make sure that it has to be a lie. And for it to be a lie, I have to make sure that I develop the truth in me. Right? If I know that I'm competent, I'm not just going to say I'm competent. No, I'm going to read some more to make sure that I'm competent and I know what I'm talking about. Right? And I'll study a little bit harder to make sure that I have my T's crossed and my I's dotted. Right? So you want to make sure that there's no truth in whatever people are saying about you, especially if they're lying, because some lies have a little more to come of truth. So we want to be careful not to just reject things right out, right? It says that 80% of adult success comes from emotional intelligence. You don't even have to be that smart. Just be emotionally intelligent and you can go far. I know we've seen a lot of people who you're like, how'd they get this job? Because they don't know nothing. They don't know the job, but they know people. And they get to where they need to get to because they know people. And we need to learn people so we can get to where we need to get to too with the knowledge. Because again, like mommy says and like daddy says, we need to poise ourselves as a church. And I don't know how many of you guys are prophetic in here. There's something coming down for our people. There's going to be a shift in power, right? And what is happening in the church is we are getting opportunities to become equipped so that when that shift in power comes, when the spoils are for the grabbing, we are ready to step into those positions, right? There's going to be positions in power, leadership for the country, in your companies. They're going to look for somebody to come at the helm to fix things. And we need to be educated. We need to be emotionally regulated. And we need to be ready to step into those positions and competently take charge. So I don't know who's listening, but there's something coming up. And we need to be ready to take it. And it's not just about power, but there's money on the line. Money belongs to the kingdom. And we have them out there living in big, big, big fancy houses, owning everything. Why my name can't be on top of somebody's building too? My building, right? And we're preparing you, right? Because we're not just saying this as somebody who's telling you things. No, we are living this. Because I will have that too, right? And we don't... We are the type of people, and she shares about this a lot. You know how we have that crabs in a barrel mentality? No, each one lift one as we climb, right? Because I'm not leaving anybody behind. And if you get too heavy, I'll let you go because that's your problem. Because if you were moving with me, you would never be heavy because we'll be moving together, right? So when you get heavy, I don't have time for that. I'll grab somebody else's hand, right? Because we're moving forward to the future, right? Okay. Self-regulation. It's a little different than self-awareness, because self-awareness means, okay, now I know. But self-regulation is, okay, I have to do something about it, right? So it's the ability to control and redirect disruptive emotions and impulses. Managing and expressing emotions appropriately, adapting to changing circumstances, maintaining integrity and accountability. Self-regulation basically is the ability to control one's behavior, emotions, and thoughts in the pursuit of long-term goals. More specifically, emotional self-regulation refers to the ability to manage your disruptive emotions and impulses. In other words, the ability to think before we act, right? So self-regulation also involves the ability to rebound from disappointment, right? And to act in a way that's consistent with your values. You ever experience a situation where people got you to act outside of yourself? And you're like, but how does this person bring me out of myself like that? I don't even cuss, but I let go some ones for them. How? How did that happen? Right? That's because we did not practice self-regulation. Right? We gave the power to somebody else, some Joe Schmo, who we don't even know who they are. We line up in the bank and they're taking too long, or somebody skip you or whatever, you know, and then you just have this outburst. End up on somebody's Instagram reel and they're talking about you and all the TT, whatever, blogs online because of your behavior, because you weren't able to self-regulate, right? So your ability to self-regulate as an adult has roots in your childhood. So learning how to self-regulate is an important skill that children learn for emotional maturity and later for social connections. So people who are able to self-regulate well tend to be able to act in accordance with their values, calm themselves when they're upset, cheer themselves on when they're feeling down, maintain open communication, persist through difficult times, put forth their best effort, remain flexible and adapting to situations, see the good in others, stay clear about their own intentions, take control of situations when necessary, and view challenges as opportunities.
So as an educational psychologist, I want to encourage y'all who have young children, start early. Because just like Dr. Jade said and Apostle said, you have to practice these skills. No one wakes up in the morning without any type of practice and are able to master the skills. So self-regulation comes with practicing. There are so many different experiences that I've had and you all have had where someone will bring you out of yourself. And that's because you have not practiced that self-regulation. Right? But once you're in a situation and you've practiced it, you've been in that situation before, then you have the skills to be able to talk to yourself, calm yourself down, provide yourself that encouragement to continue to stay in the place that you feel the most comfortable, in the place that God wants you to be, so that you don't act like a different person. But again, it does come with practice. And it starts early. So if you have young children, you got to let them have the opportunity to practice this self-regulation, be able to calm themselves, be able to encourage themselves. This is a very private practice because we have to understand as we go through life, no one is going to be able to do that for us. So it's our responsibility to ourselves to show ourselves that type of self-love to do this on a regular basis because you don't want to be out there like Dr. Jade said, coming out of yourself and people are seeing that and they see that as a demonstration of who you really are. In fact, that's not really who you are.
Motivation is the process that initiates, guides, and sustains goal-oriented behaviors. It is the internal drive or external stimulus that activates, directs, and maintains our actions toward achieving specific objectives. Motivation can be influenced by various factors, including biological, emotional, social, and cognitive forces. It plays a crucial role in determining the intensity, direction, and persistence of our efforts. Zig Ziglar says, people often say that motivation doesn't last. Well, neither does bathing. That's why we recommend it daily. Emotional intelligence involves consistently renewing your motivation. I don't know how many times we hear about encouraging ourselves. That's biblical, right? Encourage yourself in the Lord. You know that song? Right? I'm not going to sing it, but I'm sure you know it, right? We really are the ones in charge of making sure that we keep ourselves confident in whatever we're doing. We can't look necessarily for external motivation. Sometimes you want to add a boy and that makes you feel good, you know, and I'm proud of you, that makes you feel good. But sometimes you get in front of that mirror and say, Jade, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of myself. I can't believe I did that, you know. The last time somebody said something to me, I completely broke down and I was crying. But this time, I stood right there and I used my voice and I said, no. And then they told me, what do you mean no? I said, no is a complete sentence. You know, and I was proud of myself because I was able to stand my ground. And then you have to encourage yourself and motivate yourself, right? Every single day. It's not something that, you know, a confident person isn't confident because they just are. Every single day we choose confidence. Every day we wake up and say, listen, I don't care what's about to happen today. I got this. Amen. And then you walk outside like, I got this with my head up high, no matter what I left at home. It's a choice. And you have to choose it every single time. Okay? Motivation is a fire from within. If someone else tries to light that fire under you, chances are it will burn, but it will burn very briefly. Emotional intelligence means fueling your own inner fire. The difference between a successful person and others is not a lack of strength, not a lack of knowledge, but rather a lack in will. Motivation and emotional intelligence drive success.
Then Moses said, please show me your glory. Exodus chapter 33 verse 18 in the Amplified Bible. In the spring of 2022, after 2 years of the COVID-19 pandemic, God said that it was time for His church to begin preparing for the next great awakening. He said that what was coming next was a manifestation of His glory on a level that our generation had never seen before. While we have no quantitative means to prove the full extent of this, we believe that many Christians across the globe have also been looking forward to this unprecedented outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Some call it revival fire, while others call it a sovereign move of God. Some call it a shift in the Spirit or any other number of titles. Nevertheless, we're all in some way or another referring to the same thing. God's presence will be manifested on the earth in such a remarkable fashion. that it will forever change the trajectory of the Church of Jesus Christ first, and then the world. This book, Knowledge of the Glory, Preparing for the Next Great Awakening by author Donald Duncan, is a prophetic message from God to help his church prepare for it. Available in paperback, hardcover, and ebook formats. Pick up your copy today at Amazon.com or any major online bookseller. Thank you.
Jesus said, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me.